know, I was talking about it in the Bible study this morning, but I marvel at where God has taken me since I first saw the grace of God and truth, I guess around the age of 21 or so. I marvel at where he took me, because when I found that, I thought that was the end. I thought, this is the thing, this isn't the end. And I marvel at where he's taken me by revealing the grace of God and truth to me. And when I go back and listen to the messages, I marvel at some of the things that I say, because it's almost like I was prophesying of where I was going to be without knowing where I would be yet. And I remember, I guess, about a year and a half ago saying that, and this is my own definition. It isn't one that I found in the Bible. It combined part of what the definition was, but then I combined the other part of it. But grace I defined as the divine influence on the heart of man that enables him to believe about himself what God already believes to be true about him. Now, I'd never heard anybody say that before, and I didn't know why that I said it. But I just realized that this grace that God had shown me a long time ago was starting to enable me to see something about myself. And as I started seeing this thing about myself, I started realizing, wait a second, that's what God sees about me. And as I saw that, then the walls just started coming down all around me, and everything started becoming more clear. But then I started realizing the life that I was created to experience because of the grace. Because I was able to see clearly. Because I was no more had a veil over my face. Because I no more looked at the law through the carnal mind. I no more thought about the law carnally. And then after I saw what kind of life I was created for, as far as the experience of my life or the fruit of the Spirit, then I was able to see that's just a function of the Trinity, which is the life that I was created for. You see, and you can never get to that place where you see the life of your design while you're walking on this earth apart from grace. You can never get to that place. Now, when you stand before God Almighty in a happy way, if you've believed on Jesus, when you get to heaven, you'll see all that clearly right there, poof. You know, right there, okay? Your understanding will be perfect right there, bam, okay? It'll just be. You'll understand all those things in a flash of a moment. And for me, that's why it says that he'll wipe away our tears. Because we'll see all the things that are true and we'll be so blown away by it that it'll just bring tears to our face, because we'll say, my goodness, man, how could God Almighty be so infatuated with me that this is what he thinks about me and the life he could have in union with me? It'll just bring tears to your eyes. And it does it to me all the time. Just thinking about it right now, it's bringing tears to my eyes. But, you know, because we've defined life or salvation so long as something that happens in the sweet by and by, we've stripped the power of the gospel. You see, the thing is I can experience that life now. You see, I can experience that life now and then forevermore. Okay, so a long time ago, I purposed to Shema Shema, which was hearken diligently. And I don't mean that I performed some formula so that God would be happy with me. I just purposed in my heart that I wanted to know God, that I wanted to understand God now, that I wanted to experience the life I was created for now, that I didn't want to wait to the sweet by and by. And you know, as I'm hanging out there with God, it was like God said, praise the Lord, man. Praise the Lord. It's not just for the sweet by and by. It's for now. You experience salvation now. And then you experience it forevermore. So that's what the preaching of the gospel while we're here on this earth is for. And that's really what I do. And that's what I love to do. And I'll just be honest. I feel like every day I experience more of this life. I feel like every day I experience more of this life. And so I don't despise a guy who doesn't want to experience this life to the sweet by and by. But I'm just not going to adopt that wisdom. Right? I want to experience the life now. So those that want to experience the life now, then you want to walk with me. And I don't despise the guy who doesn't want to experience the life now, but I can't now turn back and go walk there. I can't go back to where I don't want to experience that life, because I've tasted the peaceable fruit of righteousness in my heart. And so I don't want to imagine a life without that fruit in my heart and without experiencing that for all my days. Right? That's the life that I want to live. And we're talking about the same thing the last few weeks, and we're going to keep talking about this, because this is a complicated, I don't want to say complicated, It's actually simple, but because we've been wired and programmed with so many different thoughts and beliefs about everything, it becomes difficult to understand sometimes. So we're going to keep talking about this so that we can shema, so that we can hearken diligently or hear and keep hearing. And we can let this thing we're talking about meditate in our hearts. And what we're talking about is what the faith of the Son of God is. Okay? Paul used the term the faith of the Son of God. He also used the term the faith of Jesus Christ. He also used the term the faith of him, okay? And he was not talking about what Jesus believed on behalf of mankind. He was not talking about something that Jesus believed on behalf of mankind. He was talking about the logic, the vital principle, or the wisdom of God that God revealed to mankind in Jesus Christ. And that's why in John chapter 1, it says the Word was made flesh. God's logic, his wisdom, was made flesh in Jesus. Okay? So when Paul talks about the faith of the Son of God, or the faith of him, or the faith of Jesus Christ, he's talking about the logic or wisdom, the vital principle that God revealed to mankind in Jesus Christ. Okay? That's what he's talking about. And so we're going to pick this back up where we were in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. And I don't know how many weeks God's going to have us sitting here talking about this, but we'll just be here for as long as we're here. But Galatians, I'm not even going to get to the second half of last week yet, because I just thought we had to go back and look at this. And I had this as a sidebar before this week even happened, but I thought we would move on, but I was wrong. This is where God has us to be right now. So Galatians 2:20, and let me see if I can put this up on the board also. Galatians 2:20. Galatians 2:20 says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Okay, so really what it would be more accurate to say is he lives by the faith known as the Son of God. Okay? The Son of God is the adjective that would describe what the faith is. Okay? That's what he's talking about. Now, as we do so often, when we get to a verse, we tend to extrapolate just that one verse, and we forget everything that Paul was talking about prior to that verse. But Galatians 2:20 is a continuation of what Paul said in Galatians 2:16. Okay, now in Galatians 2:16, Paul said, we know that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but they're justified by the faith of Jesus Christ. Okay, so Paul's telling these Galatian guys, you're not justified by the works of the law. You're not justified by what you do, by performing carnal commandments and principles. You're justified by something that's called the faith of the Son of God. Okay, the faith of Jesus Christ. So when he gets down to Galatians 2:20, this is a continuation of what he said in Galatians 2:16. He gets down to explaining what he's talking about. So he says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. He says, since I was crucified at the cross with Jesus, because Jesus is the representative of me, since I died at the cross with Jesus for us 2,000 or so years ago, he says, it's no longer I that live, but it's Christ that lives in me. He says, since I died with Christ at the cross unto sin, or the belief unto the flesh, I no longer find the report of my life in the flesh. I no longer find the report of my life in what I do, in what I have, or what happens to me in this world. He says, but rather, I find the report of my life in Christ. I find the report of my life in the resurrected Christ seated at the right hand of God, the position of honor and glory as the representation of me. Okay? So that's what he's talking about when he says it's no longer I that live. And that's just how it connects to Galatians 2:16. You see, if I no longer find the report of my life in the flesh, then I realize I cannot be justified by what I do in the flesh. Okay? And I realize then, if I now find the report of my life in the resurrected Christ seated at the right hand of God, then I would be justified by something called the faith of the Son of God, which is the logic or vital principle that God presented to mankind as a gift in Christ. Okay? So, see, human beings, when they found the identity of themselves in the flesh, they set about saying, I will justify myself in my heart as the beloved Son of God in whom he is well pleased by what I do. Okay? Now, Paul says, no, we're not justified like that, guys. We're justified by something called the faith that is known as the Son of God. And the reason we're justified by that is because we no more find the report of our life, or it's no longer I that live. I no longer find the report of my life in the flesh, which is what it means when it says it's no longer I who live, but rather I find the report of my life in the resurrected Christ seated at the right hand of God, which is what it means when it says Christ lives in me. Okay? Now, because I find the report of my life in Christ, I'm now going to want to have my heart filled with everything God has spoken to me in Christ. Because that is the thing that will cause me to be justified in my heart. Okay? Now, remember, I don't want to jump ahead too far. Okay? So, what he's saying is, because I no longer find the report of my life in the flesh in what I do, because I died with Christ on the cross with him, okay, I now find the report of my life in Christ. And because I now find the report of my life in Christ, the life I now live in the flesh, I live seeking to be justified not by what I do, but by something called the faith of the Son of God. The life I now live in the flesh, seeking to feel justified in my own heart, I don't live it by what I do or the works of the law, but rather I live this life by the logic, the vital principle God has presented to me in Jesus Christ. That's called the Son of God. That's how we live our life. So guys, you say, well, what does that look like? When you come to this church and you hear what we preach every week, you're living your life in the flesh seeking to be justified by something called the faith of the Son of God. Because every week I'm preaching about the logic, the wisdom of God that he revealed to us in Christ. Every week that's what I'm preaching about. Every week. And you see what happens is when you hear that word, it justifies you in your heart. Because if you thought God knew you according to the flesh, according to what you do, then you would think that you need to do things so that God could be happy with you. But now you see, you come to this church and you hear me tell you that God has never known you according to your flesh. He's only known you according to the resurrected Christ seated at the right hand of God. You hear me tell you that you are the beloved Son of God in whom he is well pleased, full of glory and honor. And you see, that works to justify you in your heart. You see, and what happens is you feel confidence in the presence of God when you hear that word. Now, I didn't come up with that word on my own. That's what God declared about man when he raised Jesus up from the dead as the representative of the human race and sat Jesus at his right hand as the representative of the human race. So that when we could hear his language about what he thought of us, that we could feel justified in our heart and we could now have confidence in the presence of God. So the life I now live in the flesh, that would be equivalent to walking in the Spirit. Because Jesus said, my words, they are spirit and they are life. So the life I now live in the flesh, I live walking by the Spirit. I live by being immersed into the wisdom and logic of God about my life, which is revealed in Christ. That's how I live my life now in the flesh. I live it by the immersed in the wisdom and logic of God about my life. You see? And that causes me to feel justified in my heart. And when I feel justified in my heart, what happens is it produces the life of God. Right? So something we want to understand about this, and this is difficult for us to grasp sometimes, or at least it was for me, but it's absolutely critical to experiencing the life of God on this earth. It's absolutely critical to experiencing the life I described last week, okay? But when Paul says Christ lives in me, okay, something we need to understand is that Christ is a person. He is most certainly a person. But Christ is also most certainly the wisdom and logic of God, okay? He's not only a person, he's also the wisdom and logic of God. Okay? And he's not just the wisdom of logic of God, but he's also a person. Okay? For so long what the church has done is we've ripped out Christ as the wisdom of logic of God. And we've never looked at God speaking something to us in Christ. We just looked at, well, I need to feel bad about myself, then I'll believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins, and then that'll be it. Then the Holy Spirit will indwell me, and I'll live on this earth in the sweet by and by, waiting to experience life. But that's not it, man. That's the very beginning. That is the very beginning of the life of a believer. So Christ is a person, and he is the wisdom and logic of God. So before I was saved, before I believed on Jesus, I heard a word called the faith of Jesus Christ. And I believed on that word. And Christ, the person, indwelled me through the Holy Spirit. Okay? And then Christ, the wisdom and logic, dwelled in my heart. When I heard the faith of Jesus Christ, when I heard the logic, the vital principle that's called Jesus Christ, when I heard that word, then Christ, the wisdom and logic about my life, dwelled in my heart. Okay? And so there's two different things, man. Right? When it says Christ dwells in your heart, it means that Christ becomes your understanding. He becomes your wisdom. He becomes your logic. He becomes your way of thinking. Now, the way that happens is when you hear the logic of God that's been presented in Christ. That's how that thing happens, man. Okay? So there's two different things we have going on. So when Christ, or when we talk about Christ dwelling in our heart, we're talking about the logic, the vital principle that Paul called the faith of the Son of God dwelling in your heart. We're talking about the logic, the vital principle that Paul called the faith of the Son of God becoming the core of your belief system, becoming the seat of your emotion. Okay? That's what we're talking about when we're talking about this. So the faith or the logic or the vital principle that dwells in our heart as we hear the word that God declared in Christ and are persuaded in our hearts by that word is everything that God has declared to man in the birth, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. Okay? And the preaching of the gospel is the revealing of the word God has spoken to us in Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, so that that can dwell in our hearts. Okay? So that we can feel justified in our hearts. So that what God believes about us can become our own understanding. So it can become the very thing we believe about ourselves. Okay? And I just want to look at the way this looks. If God believes something about me, and what he believes about me is the resurrected Christ seated at the right hand of God. Okay? Now, if I don't believe that about myself, then Christ is not dwelling in my heart. Christ, the wisdom and logic of God about my life, is not dwelling in my heart, okay? So for the first 15 years, or I guess I was saved, filled with the Spirit at 6 years old. For the first 15 years of my life, I had Christ, the person, living in me, but I had no idea that what God believed about me is what he revealed when he sat Jesus at his right hand, the position of honor and glory, as the representative of me. I had no idea that that's what God believed about me. So Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, was not my understanding about my life. It was not my understanding about who I was. So Christ, the wisdom and logic of God about my life, was not dwelling in my heart. Because I thought God knew me according to the flesh. I thought God was judging me according to my sins. I thought God was holding my transgressions against me. I thought God was either happy or sad with me based on what I did. Now that is a logic or an understanding in my heart that is a core of my belief system that contradicts what God believed. You see, so I had my own wisdom and logic dwelling in my heart. And then once I realized that this is what God believes about me, when I heard that was the truth, what happened was I was persuaded in my heart that that was the truth. And now Christ, the wisdom and logic about my life, could now dwell in my heart by becoming the core of my belief system, by becoming the seat of my emotion. And that changed everything I experienced in this life. It changed everything. It changed the love I experienced from God. It changed how much I loved God back. And you know what it changed more than anything? It changed how much I loved people. Because I started realizing that Christ was the wisdom and logic about their life also. And when I saw how glorious God's opinion was of every human being, I just wanted to love every human being. Now, you see, guys, I tried to love people through my own ability before Christ the wisdom and logic of God dwelled in my heart, and I tried to love them through my own willpower, and the world would say it was love, but let me tell you what, when I compare it to what I have now, it wasn't even called love. Wasn't even love at all. It was me trying to do something because I thought I was supposed to be a good Christian. See, now I don't have to try to love people. I just look at them, and when I look at them, I see the very glory of God. Do you know why I can see the glory of God? Because Christ, the wisdom and logic about that person's life, also dwells in my heart. Because if it's true about me, it has to be true about them. Now, if I never hear that word, or if that word never becomes my understanding or my way of thinking, I can never look at another person and say, behold, the glory of God. It's a great place to be when you can look at people and think that way. I'm telling you. You'll find the stress just removing from your life. Human beings will stress you out, won't they? I mean, listen, we're all being honest. We all love each other. But if we're just being honest, sometimes we can stress each other out. Right? It's a world, and there's things in the world that don't go on right. And so sometimes we can stress each other out. But, you know, when you can look at a person who used to stress you out and look at them and see just the glory of God, they no more stress you out. You see, what happens is you find compassion born in your heart for them instead of stress when they do something to you. You know, you'll say in yourself, that guy just doesn't have Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, about who he is dwelling in his heart. Hallelujah. So what does it mean for Christ, the wisdom of God, to dwell in your heart? And we'll just take a little facet of this, okay? And we're talking about the faith known as Jesus Christ, the faith known as the Son of God. And it is a logic, it is a vital principle, it is a thing. It is the wisdom of God. It's not an action, okay? So Christ, the wisdom of God, that he has revealed to us in the logic called the faith of the Son of God, says that God is no longer remembering your sins or iniquities. God is no longer remembering your sins and iniquities. That's in the Bible, guys. God, that means God's not judging you based on your sins, okay? That is the wisdom and logic of God about your sin problem, that it no more exists, that he's no more holding them against you. So Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, would be for that to dwell in your heart, for that to become the core of your belief system, for that to become the seat of your emotion, okay? And what happens is that'll shape what you feel, what you think, and what you judge to be true about yourself in this life. Because you'll say, my goodness, man, if God's no more holding my sins and iniquities against me, that will shape what you feel in your heart. You'll feel happy. You'll feel close to God. You'll no more feel far away from him. And what you'll say is, you'll judge that to be true about yourself. You'll say, God's no more holding my sins and iniquities against me. Now that is a picture of Christ, the wisdom of God, dwelling in your heart. Okay? Now, for the first part of my life, when I didn't realize that God wasn't holding my sins and iniquities against me, I thought he was holding them against me. So I did not have Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, dwelling in my heart, even though I had Christ the person living in me. You see, so we preach the gospel so the persuasion in all of our hearts can be perfected. And that's what justified means. It means for the persuasion in your heart to be perfected, and it's perfected by the wisdom and logic of God that he revealed to man in Christ. That's what perfects it. So we'll look at an example of Greg, okay? And I talked about this before, but my learning curve for experiencing the life of God, it started off kind of like this, slow like this, slow like this. But now, the last 3 years, the learning curve has accelerated up, okay? And one of the biggest things that happened was I got the revelation that God never knew me according to the flesh. I got the revelation that God never knew me according to what I do, what I have, or what happens to me in this world. I got the revelation that he's always known me according to the resurrected Christ seated at the right hand of God. You see, and what happened was, when I got that revelation, Christ, the wisdom and logic of God about my life, dwelled in my heart. It became the core of my belief system. It became the seat of my emotions. And it started shaping what I feel, what I think, and what I judge to be true about my life. And that's what Paul was talking about when he said, I pray that you have an experiential knowledge of the love that is of Christ. He was praying that we would experience and feel something. Well, the only way you can experience and feel this love that is of Christ is if Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, dwells in your heart or becomes the core of your belief system. Because the Bible says that the heart, or the core of your belief system, is the very thing that determines what you feel, what you think, and what you judge to be true about your life. You see, I never felt the love that is of Christ like I do now. Even though I've been saved for many, many years, filled with the Spirit many, many years, seeking the Lord many, many years, going to Bible college many, many years, studying the Scriptures, I'd never experienced the love that is of Christ, even like I had even just this last year. Even just this last year. It's like gangbusters. You know what I'm saying? Now, do you know why? Because my heart, or the persuasion that I live from, my understanding, my way of thinking, has been justified more and more and more. It's been perfected more and more and more as Christ, the wisdom and logic of God about my life in the relationship with Him that I've been created for, has dwelled in my heart. That will make you happy, man. And so, listen, as the church, we have to be careful how we explain these things. And me too. I have to be careful how I explain these things because I'm me. And so sometimes I'll preach from the platform of what I know and what I think. But there's a bunch of people who aren't me, who don't think like I think, or heard what I've heard, or walked the same walk that I've walked. And so it's important to go back and talk about these things. And it's critical for every believer. Now, it's only critical for you if you want to experience the love that is of Christ right now while you're on this earth. If you don't want to experience that, then this isn't critical for you. Okay? If you're just content being like this, you don't have to worry about this. But it's critical for the church to understand that Christ the person dwells in us when we believe, okay? But then Christ the wisdom and logic of God about our life dwells in our heart, or becomes the core of our belief system, as we continue to hear the word of faith, as we continue to hear the word that God revealed to us in Christ. That's the purpose of hearing the gospel. That's why if you go to a church that's full of legalism and they preach a word to you about legalism, you'll feel bad on the inside because you'll hear that God is angry with you, and you'll hear that God says you're not doing enough. You'll hear that God is holding your sins and iniquities against you. Now, what will happen is that will become the core of your belief system. That will become the seat of your emotion. It will shape what you feel, what you think, and what you judge to be true about your life, and you'll feel bad. Because you won't feel justified in your heart. You won't find an emotion in your heart that says, I'm the beloved Son of God, in whom He's well pleased, full of glory and honor. What you'll say is, I don't know if I'm a son or not. Because God's angry with me. I haven't measured up to the standard. See, that's a picture of the two different wisdoms dwelling in a person's heart. Okay? Hallelujah. So I'm going to get back to this, and this is going to be called being filled with the fullness of God. We're going to get back to Ephesians chapter 3, starting with verse 14, and the part we're going to look at is that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. So when he says that he prayed that you'd be strengthened with might in the inner man by the Spirit, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height. And that word "and" means even. So he's explaining what he meant. He says, even to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, when he says to know the love of Christ, he's not talking about to know that Christ loves you, although Christ does love us, and that is in the Bible. But he's not talking about knowing that Christ loves you. He's talking about to know the love that is of Christ. Okay? He's talking about us experiencing something in our lives. He's talking about us feeling something. And so the love that is of Christ is the love that can come when the vital principle or the logic that God presented to mankind in Christ, called the faith of the Son of God, can become the core of your belief system or can become the seat of your emotion. Okay? That is what it means to know the love that is of Christ. Right? Notice he says that he's praying. Paul said he prayed for Christ to dwell in their hearts or become the core of their belief system so they could feel or experience the love or the life that is defined by love and as love. Okay? So he prayed for Christ to dwell in their hearts in order that they could experience the love that is of Christ. The love that can come when Christ, the wisdom of God, becomes the core of your belief system. Okay? That's what he was praying for them, right? He wanted Christ to become the core of their belief system in order for them to experience or feel the love that is of Christ. In order to experience and feel the life that is defined by love and as love. Okay? Now, like I said, for so long I read these verses and I thought all these verses sound so good. You see, they sounded good and I was happy for a little while. But then something happened. I started realizing, wait a second, I'm not really experiencing exactly how awesome those verses sound. You know, I read them and they sound good. But in my heart, I realized I'm not experiencing how awesome those verses sound in my day-to-day life. You know, I'm experiencing something sometimes. It's like when I needed it really bad, I could experience some comfort. But I was not experiencing this on a day-to-day level. And the reason why I was not experiencing it is because I just knew it in my head. I just knew that God is love in my head, and I had no idea what that meant. I had no idea what that was talking about. Okay? Because the vital principle or logic of God, which is Christ, had not dwelled in my heart yet. So I was unable to experience the life that is described as, or to experience the love that is of Christ. Okay? So when he talks about love, guys, when he talks about experiencing the love that is of Christ, he's not just talking about us experiencing the Father's love for us. He's not just saying for us to experience the Father's love for us, okay? It is part of that, and that is great. It's great to experience the Father's love for us, but it's also talking about what you experience and feel in your heart when you find the perfect love that the Father has for you being born in your heart back towards Him. That's what it's also talking about, okay? So to know the love that is of Christ is to know the life that's defined as love, which is defined by me experiencing the love the Father has for me in my heart, feeling and experiencing it to such a degree that it produces that same love, that same perfect love in my heart back towards the Father. Okay? That's what it means to experience the life or to experience the love that is of Christ. So we want to look at this word love in the Greek. And we could see this. The word love means to be loved. Absolutely. Okay? So we experience the love of God for us. But it also means to love back. It also means for us to love back. So the definition of the Greek word does not just mean I experience some love. What it means is that it will cause me to love back. Okay? The love that I experience will cause me to love back. Now listen what else it means. It means to breathe after. It means to breathe after. Now, it means to breathe after, as in the sense that when God looked upon us, he was so overwhelmed with the love that he felt for us that he lost his breath. It's like when I looked upon Becky. I was so overwhelmed with her beauty. I was so overwhelmed with the love that I felt in my heart for Becky that I lost my breath. It took my breath away. So the love that is of Christ is to find an emotion born in your heart that says, when God looked upon you, he was so overcome with the good thoughts he had about your life that it took his breath away, that he lost his breath when he looked upon you. Okay? That is what it means to experience and feel the love of the Father. It's to feel in your heart that when God looked at me, God Almighty, when he looked at me, he felt contentment. He looked at me and he said, I don't see a need to add anything to this person. I am satisfied with this person. He was satisfied with the life he could spend with us in union with him. Okay? So he lost his breath when he looked upon us. Now you're starting to experience what is called the love that is of Christ. Okay? Now what happens when you feel this love that the Father has expressed for you, and the way that you feel this is by the faith or the logic or the vital principle called the faith of the Son of God becoming the core of your belief system. And this is how faith produces love. Okay? We always had it backwards and thought love produced faith. No. Faith produces love. And not what I believe, but faith, the vital principle, the logic of God, produces this life that is called the love that is of Christ. You see that? So, when I feel in my heart that God Almighty lost his breath when he looked upon me, that he was so overwhelmed with his love for me that he lost his breath, what happens is I find in my heart that same kind of love being back towards the Father. I find that same kind of love being born in my heart back towards the Father. The same kind of love that's defined as, I find myself so in love with God, when I think about how good God is, when I think about how wonderful the Father is, I find that it takes my breath away. I lose my breath when I think about how great God was. And guys, I'm just going to be honest. For the first 15 years of my Christian life, and primarily from age 15 to 24, I believed God was good. And I believed that I loved God in my heart. And I did, to the best of my ability. But do you know, every time something went wrong around me, I would become aggravated and angry with God? And I'd wonder why God did this to me? And I'd wonder why this happened, why that happened? You see, now that no more happens to me. You see, I no more get upset. I no more even become angry about why I think something in my life isn't going so well. Because what's happened is I find a perfect love that's been born in my heart back towards the Father, because I realize when he saw me, he lost his breath. He was so in love with me. And now I find that same kind of a description of love being born in my heart back towards him. Hallelujah. So this is what it means to know what is the love. This is what it means to know the love that is of Christ. It's to know the love that can come when Christ dwells in your heart by becoming the core of your belief system. When Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, can become the core of your belief system. And you'll start experiencing this love more and more and more and more every day. Every day you'll experience it more. This morning I experienced it while Gabe was playing that song, You Are My Heaven. I just experienced it a little bit more. Okay? So this leads us to that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. So Paul prays that Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, would dwell in our hearts, that we might know the love that is of Christ so that we could be filled with the fullness of God. Okay? So he describes that to know or experience the love that is of Christ, he equals that. He says that is the same thing as being filled with the fullness of God. Okay? So to experience and feel the love that is of Christ is to be filled with the fullness of God. That's what it is. Okay? So Paul prayed that Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, would dwell in our hearts so we could be filled with the fullness of God. Now, how does experiencing and feeling the love that is of Christ cause us to be filled with the fullness of God? Has anybody ever wondered that? And I'm just going to talk about this. Because God is love. Okay? God is love. The Bible says that God is love. Okay? And what that means is, and I'm probably just going to read this so we can get it. To experience this love is to find the fullness of the Godhead dwelling in you bodily, because God is this love. Okay? Or Father, Son, and Spirit is this love. The relationship between Father and Son, by way of the Spirit, by the faith known as the Son of God, is defined by this love and as this love. Therefore, to experience this love is to be filled with the fullness of Father, Son, and Spirit. Because Father, Son, and Spirit equals love. And so if I'm experiencing the love that is of Christ, that means I've been filled full with God. It means I've been filled full with Father, Son, and Spirit. Because Father, Son, and Spirit is love. And so to know the love that is of Christ, which passeth a mere head knowledge or a mere understanding that it exists, to feel and experience the love that is of Christ causes me to be filled full with the fullness of God, because God is that love. Father, Son, and Spirit is that love. So what happens, guys, when it says that you be filled with the fullness of God, it means the human being was made to be filled full with Father, Son, and Spirit. We were created, guys, for the fullness of Father, Son, and Spirit to dwell in us bodily, that we could experience the love that is of Christ. Hallelujah. Man, that will revolutionize your life as you continue to walk into this. Okay? So Paul prayed that the faith of him, or the logic and vital principle that God presented to us in Christ, would dwell in our hearts in order that we'd be strengthened with the strength, or in order that we'd be strengthened with might in the inner man by the Spirit, in order that we'd be strengthened with the strength that is of Christ, in order that we would feel justified in our hearts so that we could know, so that we could feel and experience the love that is of Christ, and thereby being filled with the fullness of God. For God is love. Praise the Lord. So in Ephesians 3:12, Paul says, we have access into this life by the faith of him. So the life that I just described, a life that's defined by love and as love, before Paul started praying his prayer, right before he started praying the prayer that Christ would dwell in their hearts, he says something. He says, we have access into this life, into this fellowship that was a mystery for all time before Christ came. He says, we have access into this life that was a mystery by the faith of him. Okay? Now, he's not saying, again, he's not saying that we have access into the life found in the fellowship of the Trinity by Jesus believing on our behalf. He's not saying that we have access into the fullness of God by Jesus believing on our behalf. Because if that were the case, then nobody would ever have to believe to be saved. None of us. So he's not saying that we have access into the life that I just described by Jesus believing on our behalf. He's saying we have access into this life by the logic or vital principle, by the wisdom of God that he presented to man in Christ Jesus. That's called the faith of him. And so this tells us what he was praying for when he prayed that Christ would dwell in our hearts. Because if he said that we have access into this life by the faith of him, then what is it that he would be praying for other than the faith of him to dwell in our hearts? Now, the faith of him is a logic. It is a vital principle. It is the wisdom of God. And he says when this wisdom of God can become the core of your belief system, when it can become the seat of your emotions, then you will experience and feel the love that is of Christ, and you will be filled full with the fullness of God. You'll be filled full with Father, Son, and Spirit. Okay? And so his prayer has to be that it be the logic and wisdom of God that dwells in our heart, because in verse 12, he says we have access into that life by the faith of him. And it is not that I have access into that life by him believing on my behalf, because then I don't have to believe at all. And then it doesn't matter if anybody believes. We're all just saved. We're all just in that life. Guys, that's heresy. Because the only way you can have access into the life is if you have the same vital principle or logic that makes the life work. And so Paul's prayer became that you would have this vital principle or logic called the faith of him, or the faith known as Jesus Christ, dwell in your heart. And he says that will strengthen you in your inner man with might. He says that will strengthen you with the strength that is of Christ. Now, to be strengthened in your inner man with might, or to be strengthened with the strength that is of Christ, is to be justified in your heart. You see, and as you feel justified in your heart, you know what happens? You no more feel ashamed of saying, I'm about to go stand face to face with God, and I'm going to feel confident. You see, and that's how you start experiencing the fellowship in the Trinity. Because you can only experience the fellowship in the Trinity from the platform of Son. Because we are created to occupy the position of Son. So the only way you can experience the fellowship and life in the Trinity is by standing face to face with God. Okay? Well, unless I feel justified in my heart, I won't stand face to face with God. I'll be ashamed and I'll run away. So the purpose of the faith of him, or the logic or wisdom that God presented to mankind in Christ, the purpose of that dwelling in your heart is so that you would be justified in your heart. and you would stand face to face with God and feel confidence. And then what would happen is you'll be strengthened with might. You'll know the love that is of Christ, which passeth mere understanding, and you'll be filled full with the fullness of God. Now, God right there, guys, is talking about Father, Son, and Spirit. And so to feel the love that is of Christ is to be filled full of God, because God is love. Father, Son, and Spirit is love. The relationship between Father and Son by way of the Spirit, or the faith that is known as Jesus Christ, is love. That's how the human being can be filled full of God. That's how you can be filled with the fullness of God. Listen, man, I'm filled full with the fullness of God. I'm just saying. And it's because of this. It's because I understand this. It's because I understand that I am not justified in my heart by what I do, but rather I am justified in my heart by the wisdom and logic of God that God presented to me as a gift in Christ Jesus that Paul called the faith of the Son of God. You see, and the church has lost sight of what the faith of the Son of God is. We've lost sight of it completely. So Paul defines what his prayer is, man. He says we have access by the faith of him. So you have two options. You can either say the faith of him means Jesus believed on my behalf. That's option one. Option two is that the faith of him is a noun, and it's talking about the wisdom and logic, the vital principle of God that he presented to us in Jesus Christ. Those are your only two options, man. So unless you're going to walk out of here being a universalist, which means you don't have to believe at all, you're left with understanding that the access into the life that Paul's talking about here is the wisdom and logic of God that he presented to us in Christ. And that's what he's praying that would dwell in our hearts. Now, the only way it can dwell in your hearts is if you hear the word. The only way it can dwell in your hearts is if somebody preaches it to you. How shall they know unless there's a preacher? Paul said, faith comes by hearing. Not my ability to believe, but faith, the logic, the vital principle that is known as the faith of the Son of God, comes by hearing it. It becomes the core of my belief system as I hear it. So I just want to remind people what justified is. It's not something that happens in the heart of God. It's something that happens in our heart. See, Adam didn't feel like he was the beloved Son of God in whom he is well pleased. Adam felt like he was a worm, and so he ran and hid from God. So to be justified in my heart is that I believe in my heart that I am the beloved Son of God in whom he is well pleased, full of glory and honor. It's for you to believe in your heart that you are the beloved daughter of God in whom he is well pleased, full of glory and honor. That's the emotion that will be born in your heart when you're justified in your heart. Okay? Now, the only way to be immersed into the fellowship in the Trinity, or the life we just described, that is described as to feel and experience the love that is of Christ, is if you're justified in your heart. The only way to be immersed into the fellowship of the Trinity while you're on this earth is if you feel justified in your heart. Now, Paul said back in Galatians 2:16 that we know that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. So Paul told us the way that we are immersed into the fellowship of the Trinity is by our hearts being justified, as Christ, the wisdom and logic of God, will dwell in our hearts. Hallelujah. And so this answers the question of why Paul would pray for Christ to dwell in their heart. You see, the reason I preach the gospel, you know, I'm just going to be honest with you guys here, and that's how I always am. I am very concerned about the eternal salvation of all people. But I'm just going to say something. I'm equally concerned with people who have already believed experiencing that salvation right now. I am equally concerned with that, okay? Now, because I know that the only way to experience that life now is for you to be justified in your heart, and because I know that you cannot be justified in your heart by the works of the law or by the flesh or by what you do, because I know that you can only be justified in your heart by the wisdom and logic of God called the faith of Jesus Christ, I will preach every day for the rest of my life the wisdom and logic of God, which is Christ. which is something Paul called the faith of Jesus Christ, so that you could be justified in your heart and you could be immersed into the life and fellowship found in the Trinity, a life defined by love and as love. And so that defines ministry on the earth. You know, we got real caught up into this whole concept of, let me get as many people to pray the prayer and then I'm gone. Let me get them to pray the prayer, be concerned for their eternal salvation, and then I'm gone. But if that was the Apostle Paul's concern, he wouldn't have wrote in any of his letters. For he wrote his letters to believers. Clearly, they were not experiencing the life of their design. And clearly, he knew that there was something that would cause them to experience the life of their design. And then he preached from that platform. So his desire was that they could experience the love that is of Christ, because in experiencing the love that is of Christ, they would be filled with the fullness of God. And he says the only way that can happen is for the people to feel justified in their heart. And the thing that justifies them in their heart is the logic or the vital principle God presented to mankind as a gift in Christ that Paul called the faith of Jesus Christ. You guys are no more going to be able to walk out of here thinking that the faith of Jesus Christ is talking about what Jesus believed. And see, what happens is it happens by repetition. And I'm doing this on purpose. I'm doing this on purpose. You know, my whole life I thought that was talking about what Jesus believed. But in my heart I said, how can that be? How can I be justified in my heart by what Jesus believed? That would mean I don't have to believe at all. And that's why the universalist section has been created. Because they see that verse and say, wait a second, we're justified by something Jesus believed. Well, then I don't have to believe anything. What does it matter? See, that'll get you off squirrely if you start thinking like that. And what will happen is your faith will become shipwrecked. That's what will happen. Hebrews 8:10, we're just going to look at this. Man, I can't get through any of this. This is horrible. Hebrews 8:10 says, for this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. Okay? Now, in the context of what the Apostle Paul is talking about here, he's explaining what causes a person to feel justified in their heart in the presence of God. You see, the Jewish people only thought the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies and stand in the presence of God. Okay, but Paul says in the new covenant, God will put his law in your heart, okay? And when God puts his law in your hearts and in your minds, it will cause you to feel justified in your heart in the presence of God. It will cause you to feel justified walking up into the Holy of Holies and standing face to face with the glory of God. And that's the context of what Paul is talking about in Hebrews chapter 8. Because the Jewish people believed that only the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies. Only the high priest could go stand face to face with God. And Paul comes in and says, listen, man, it's no more like that. God will put his law in your hearts and your minds, and you will feel justified in your heart. And all can walk in to the Holy of Holies and stand in the presence of God and stand face to face with God. That's what he means when he says, all shall know God. All shall be able to become one with God. And it doesn't mean all, everybody, whether they believe or not. It means all those that believe, all those that receive or are persuaded by the law of God. So when Paul says that God will put his law into their mind and write them in their hearts, what he's saying is that God, God's law will become your understanding. His law will become your way of thinking. His law will become the core of your belief system. It will become the seat of your emotions, so that you will feel confident standing in the presence of God. You see, what happened was, because man adopted a wisdom or an understanding that was contrary to God's understanding, their understanding became stained with sin. It became stained with a logic that said that their heart became filled with a logic that said, the only way I can justify myself in the presence of God is by what I do through my flesh, by performing carnal principles and commandments. They said, the only way I can feel justified in the presence of God is by what I do, okay? And because of that, they could never enter into the Holy of Holies. And so the veil in the Holy of Holies that separated the temple represented man's sin-stained conscience. It represented man's sin-stained conscience keeping them out of the presence of God. Because if your conscience is stained with an emotion that says, I do not have the same glory in myself that God has in him, but I will do things, I will perform principles and commandments so that I can have the glory God has. If my conscience is stained with that, I'll never be able to go into the Holy of Holies. And so the veil represented man's sin-stained conscience, keeping them out of the Holy of Holies. That's why it says that when Jesus' flesh was torn, the veil was torn in two. It represented man's sin-stained conscience, the belief unto the flesh. Okay? Now, we'll finish up with this explanation. And I preached on this before, but I find that nobody else really preaches on it, so I'm going to explain it again. And I'll explain it in a different way, because it's everywhere. But guys, remember, Jesus came and revealed what the law is. Jesus came on the scene and revealed what the law of God is. Okay? He showed up and said, I am the law of God. Okay? And he revealed to all of us that the law God puts on our hearts, the law that he puts in our minds, is Christ. That's what he revealed to us. Okay? Now, the Jews every year, they celebrate something called the Feast of Tabernacles. And they celebrate this every year from the time of the Exodus, from the time that they were led out of Egypt. Okay? God implemented this in the Old Testament. And it's called the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, what they're celebrating in the Feast of Tabernacles is God with them, or what they thought God with us looked like. Okay? Now, the Jewish people thought that God with us was God with us in the form of the Torah or the law, to be a light unto their feet and a lamp unto their way, unto eternal life, unto glory, unto immortality. So the Jews, when they celebrated the Feast of Tabernacles, which was celebrating God with us, they were celebrating God with them in the form of the word Torah, which is the Hebrew word for law. Torah is the Hebrew word for law. So they were celebrating God with them in the form of the Torah or the law as a light unto their feet and a lamp unto their way to lead them into eternal life, to lead them into immortality, or to lead them into glory. Now, the problem was, guys, is that the Jewish people looked at the law carnally. They looked at the law with a carnal mind. And what they thought the Torah was God's teaching and instruction to man about the carnal commandments and principles man could perform in order to have eternal life, in order to have immortality, in order to be revealed full of glory. So they thought that the law of God, or the teaching and instruction of God, was contained in carnal commandments and principles, and these carnal commandments and principles were a light unto their feet and a lamp unto their way unto eternal life or immortality. That's what the Jewish people thought. Okay? Now, something interesting happens in John chapter 8. And I'm starting to realize John chapter 8, or John, the Gospel of John, is all about the revelation of Jesus as the law of God. Okay? But we want to look at John chapter 8. And in John chapter 8, it's the I think it's verse 11. If for those of you that want to turn there, let me just make sure so you could see. John chapter 8, verse 11. And like I always say, if you guys want to go, feel free to go. I may not stop. I may preach till everybody leaves. I just really wanted to get through this. John chapter 8, verse 12. John chapter 8, verse 12. And if you look at back in John chapter 7, verse 37, it says in the last day, that great day of the feast. The Feast of Tabernacles is called that great day of the feast. That's what they called it. Okay? Now, the day after, which was the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles, was a holy convocation unto the Lord. And so it was the eighth day. And what they did on the eighth day, what the Jews did on this eighth day, is they had a big celebration in the temple, okay? And they erected these big, huge candlesticks that propelled this huge light in the temple that would shine off of the Temple Mount. And they had all the lights everywhere in the temple to celebrate the Torah, or the law of God, being a light unto their feet or a lamp unto their way. They were celebrating the Torah or the law of God as the teaching and instruction to their hearts and minds unto eternal life, unto glory, or unto immortality. Okay? So Jesus, on this day in John 8, he's in the temple. He's in the temple, and he actually just had the experience with the woman that was thrown in front of him, caught in the act of adultery. Now, something interesting that happens on this day, the last day of the great feast, when they're celebrating the law or the Torah as the teaching and instruction of God, as a light under their feet and a lamp unto their way, they're also celebrating the end of one Torah cycle, or an old Torah cycle, and the beginning of a new Torah cycle. Every year they had a cycle. And on this day, they would close the end of one old cycle, and they would begin a new cycle. Okay? So this is what the Jewish people were celebrating on this day. Now what happens is, Jesus stands up in the temple and declares, "I am the light of the world." He stood in the temple and declared, "I am the light of the world." Now, by declaring that he was the light of the world, he was declaring that he is the manifestation of what the law of God is. He was declaring that he is the manifestation of what the Torah is. He is declaring that "I am what the law of God actually is, guys, and I am a light unto your feet and a lamp unto your way, unto eternal life and immortality." So Jesus stands up and he blows these guys' minds away because they thought it was the written word that was the light unto their feet. Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." And thus revealing to them that I am the revelation and the manifestation of what the Torah is. Now, you know what's awesome? Is this is the very day that they would have closed an old cycle of the Torah. So Jesus stands up on the very day that they would start a new cycle of the Torah and declares that he is the revelation of what the Torah is. Declaring that "I am the beginning of a new cycle of Torah. I am the beginning of a new kind of a life where you no more seek to be justified in your heart by performing the works of the law, by seeking carnal commandments and principles to follow, but I am the law of God that will justify your heart. I will cause you to feel justified in your heart. I will be a light unto your feet and a lamp unto your way, unto eternal life." You see, we still do that now, guys. We looked at the law of God as if it's some commandments for us to follow. But that's the letter of the law. Jesus is the spirit of the law. And this is what Paul was talking about, where he said, in the new covenant, we are not ministers of the letter of the law, but we're ministers of the spirit of the law. When Jesus declared that he was the light of the world, he was declaring that he is the spirit of the law. That's what he was declaring. So the law, guys, that God puts on our hearts and minds in Hebrews so that we could be justified in our hearts and feel confidence in the presence of God, so we could feel confidence face to face with God, is Christ and him crucified. Because that word says that God does not know us according to the flesh. He does not know us according to what we do. He only knows us according to the resurrected Christ seated at the right hand of God. And when that word dwells in my heart, I feel confidence in the presence of God. And I see that Jesus is the law of God. Jesus is the teaching and instruction to my heart. He is the teaching and instruction to my mind. You see, now Jesus becomes my understanding. He becomes my way of thinking because he is the law of God. Hallelujah. How far are we on the CD, Dad? Well, that's about as long as I can go, so tell me when that's it, because I want to get this on recording. So, guys, Jesus is the law of God, right? You want to get this idea out of your head that the law of God is something he's commanded us to perform. He is the law of God, and yes, the premise of the law is true. It was given to teach and instruct our hearts and minds. It was given to become our understanding, our way of thinking. That whole premise is true. The thing is that is Jesus and not some carnal commandments and principles for us to follow. Okay? So this is how God teaches us and instructs our hearts. Now, since we went to that story, I'll just use this example real quick of being taught a math problem. You know, we want to see how the law can dwell in our hearts. You know, when I was, I guess maybe in preschool or kindergarten, they taught you what it means to add something, right? what an addition sign is? They teach you that to add something means to combine the two, like 2 + 2 = 4. Now, that's an example of a law, okay? They had to teach me that that was true. And what they did was they taught and instructed my heart that this plus sign means that I combine two things, okay? Now, what happened is that teaching and instruction about what addition is, it dwelled in my heart. It became the core of my belief system. It became the seat from where I understood all equations from that place forward, right? It determined what I felt and what I thought and what I judged about any equation that I would ever look at for the rest of my life. And it's the same way with Jesus as the law of God, dwelling in our hearts, instructing our minds, becoming our understanding and our way of thinking about who we are and about our life. Hallelujah. So we're going to look. This is going to blow people's minds away, or it blows my mind away. I get more excited, I think, than most people. But right before Jesus stood up and said that I am the light of the world, thus signifying I am the revelation of what the law is and what the Torah is, he had just finished dispatching all the people who wanted to condemn the woman caught in adultery. Okay? Now, we all know the story of the woman caught in adultery, right? Now, they caught this woman in the act of adultery, and they bring her to Jesus, and they say, Moses says, such should be stoned. What say you? And they were looking to trick him up. They were looking to prove that he was a false prophet. Okay? They were looking to get him to contradict the law of Moses because he was going around preaching that man's sins were forgiven. And they were saying, how can you do that? This woman should be stoned. If he says that this woman's sins are forgiven, then he'll be revealed as a false prophet because he'll have contradicted Moses. Okay? So when it says that Moses says such should be stoned, what it's saying is the law of Moses condemns her to death. The law of Moses says she should die. Now, guys, you know what Jesus did in the middle of the temple? He started writing on the stones with his finger. Now, the Bible says that the law was written by the finger of God. The finger of God. So when Jesus kneeled down, when they told him that, and started writing on the stones in the middle of the temple, he was telling those guys, I am the law of God. He was telling those guys, I am the revelation of what the law of God is. Now watch what he does as the law of God. So the law of God stands up. And do you know what the law of God does for this woman who was caught in the act of adultery? It removes every accusation against her life. It removes all the accusers. And you know what the law of God did? It declared her innocence. So the law of God stood up and removed every accusation against this woman's life, every accusation against who she was, and he declared her innocence. He said, neither do I condemn you. He was doing that as a picture of the law of God. And so now we see that the law of God, the work of the law of God in the earth, is to declare the innocence of mankind. For that is what Jesus, as the revelation of the law of God, did in the temple. He declared the innocence of that woman. And that's why immediately after he did that, he stood up and said, I am the light of the world. I am the law of God. You know, if you're really zealous about the law of God, we see Jesus as the manifestation of the law of God, declaring the innocence of that woman. So if you're really zealous about the law of God, then you'd be running around the earth declaring the innocence of all mankind. Because that's what Jesus, as the revelation of the law of God, did. Do you see what Jesus did with that woman, though? We have a perfect picture of this. He taught her heart. He taught her mind so that his word about her life could become her understanding. It could become her way of thinking. So his word about her life could become the core of her belief system, the seat of her emotion, so that she could experience the love that is of Christ, so she could be filled full with the fullness of God. That's what the law of God does, guys. Now, we see this exact thing happening at the cross. When Jesus died at the cross, he removed the accusation. He removed every accusation or claim that sin had against mankind. He removed every accusation and claim that sin had against mankind. He was the law of God. And then in the resurrection, in the ascension of Jesus to the right hand of God, we see God declaring by the law of God, the innocence of mankind. In the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, he was the law of God. Now that law will dwell in my heart. When I hear that it's true and I believe on it, it will dwell in my heart. It will become the core of my belief system. It will become the seat of my emotion, and it will shape what I feel. And the feeling that it will give me is the love that is of Christ. Hallelujah, man. So you see, now we can understand what lawless is. If Jesus is the law of God, and the law of God declared the innocence of that woman that was caught in adultery, if he removed every accusation, to be lawless would to be running around declaring guilt and judgment of people. To be without the law of God would be to run around and impute sins to people. It would be to run around and judge people according to the flesh. It would be to run around and judge people according to what they do. That would be lawless. For the law of God declares the innocence of mankind. That innocence can become the core of their belief system. So when Jesus says, neither do I condemn you, he's saying, I don't condemn you to a life defined by the flesh. You see, the Pharisees tried to condemn her to a life defined by the flesh. Satan is the accuser, and he tries to condemn us to a life defined by the flesh. Jesus, when he says, neither do I condemn you, he says, I don't condemn you to a life defined by the flesh. And when he says, go and sin no more, the word sin does not mean go and don't keep committing adultery. He says, go and no longer find the definition of your life in the flesh. Because when you find the testimony of your life and what you do are in the flesh, it produces the works of the flesh. Hallelujah, man. So this is a picture. Jesus is the picture of Christ, the wisdom and logic of God. And we see how that wisdom and logic declares something to us and about us. And for that wisdom and logic to become the core of our belief system is for that wisdom and logic to dwell in our hearts. And the way that it dwells in our hearts is by the hearing of faith, or the hearing of the vital principle called the faith of the Son of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Father, we just thank you for this life, Lord. Father, my prayer today is that Christ may dwell in the hearts of all the people here and all the people they come in contact. That Christ, your wisdom and your logic about their life could dwell in their hearts. That it could become the very core of their belief system. That it can become the seat of their emotions, that they could be strengthened with might in the inner man, that they could know, that they could experience and feel the love that is of Christ, that they could be filled with the fullness of God. Thank you, Father, that this is your will. Thank you, Father, that this is your purpose, that you're working in the earth right now, that this is not something that's laborious for you, but this is something that makes you happy. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Go back and read John 8, all you Bible students.